I was somehow under the impression that this would be a small, manageable group and I could get away with whatever I said. This looks like a very difficult proposition. Now, I must first thank Lila Prism, because it's really a prism, because a prism has many colors and sides. So when his view wrote to me, I didn't know whether to be he or a she. And we went on communicating. And then we moved on to the topic. Tried to negotiate, failed. Having said that, I first also thank Mr. Subhash Agarwal. He has said nice words, but if you have been on the receiving side of his RTIs, you would know that behind this pleasant smile hands hides a passion to expose the truth. He has said that we both came from very middle class backgrounds. I fully agree. Just an addenda, I continue to remain solidly struggling middle class. In my vocation, there are people who have risen above the middle class. Yeah, they have risen above the middle class, but I perhaps could never learn the virtue. Now, this subject is very fascinating, and I pick up this subject because they help us go through the domain of the topic. These are both words. One is a traditional word, mass communication, which stands for a subject in itself, which is rather popular. But the other is a nexus that we have to either establish or destroy. Can mass communication lead to transformative governance or not? Now that is giving mass communication a sense of purpose, a belonging that perhaps people in mass communication don't know. I have been on both sides of the media, on the receiving end, so there are scars here, like any civil servant. And now on the side of media, I take extreme pleasure in giving it back. Mr. Subhash Agarwal's instrument, or the instrument to which he belongs, RTI, has proved to be a godsend. But I'll tell you the story of how it was introduced later on, not today. That remains a secret. To start with the subject, Garabeta. Yes. Mass communication and transformative governance. I first start almost like a bit of a teacher with every word. Mass communication, it's evolution. You see, mass communication is not the type they teach you in Jamia or some other place. It started much, much earlier. It was codified and made into an academic subject much later. It starts with a drum beater who goes around 1,000 years ago mentioning that this is what we have to convey to you, the drum beater or whatever. In fact, the Muezzin himself came from that background in what was, it's part of Islam. The Harkar, the one who calls the faithful, is also a mass communicator. The siren alert, this is actually the gong that churches took over. The church tower, which you have a gong to inform people that this is happening, this is an alarm. And you move on, the pamphlet here. After Gutenberg's press comes out, people start writing their own and then put that into lead press, the wooden press, and bring out pamphlets. The pamphlet here is very much a mass communicator. And the mass meetings. Mass meetings have been a part of our democratic upsurge in the late 19th and 20th centuries. Then comes the second stage of evolution, where we have the radio. The radio starts as an experiment with airwaves in the 1920s. It started much earlier, but it was successful from, let us say, 1920s, and becomes the most powerful medium. It starts with shortwave that can go up to about 500 kilometers easily. 500 kilometers easily in those days, 500, 600 kilometers. The British had, for instance, their their propaganda machine stationed in a particular plant of the Indian subcontinent. So when they left, that government didn't know what to do with it. It was called the South Asia Command. It became Vivid Bharati, Radio Ceylon, the Dinaka Geetmala, the same transmitters. Film comes in, and we just celebrated 100 years of Indian film. It's also a form of communication, and then the TV grips the whole world. Television comes over in India, starts in the 70s, but actually picks up from 82 after Asia. By 92, it had reached maturity. By 97, government had lost its monopoly. Prasar Bharati had to be created most unwillingly, and the ball was set rolling. Private licenses got it. By 2002, it was all demonopolized. Other form of mass communication that has charmed the world has been what I call the demagogues. Hitler. His form of communication is a study in itself. How he would darken the audience, how martial music would go on through the afternoon, how he would get up the stairs with drum beats and then lights would flash off and then lights would go on. And he had a huge screen where if I put a finger, it would go up about 40 feet. Question of getting the masses on to watch an otherwise very diminutive man. Mussolini was also a great speaker. Nasser, Sukarno. They said when Sukarno spoke at the Merdeka Stadium, took his handkerchief out, 100,000 people took their handkerchiefs out. That is mass communication. This is again direct contact, again orators. Atal Bihari, he I think was the finest orator I have heard. Mr. Modi is a good orator. Now don't ask me where the orator and demagogue begins and ends. I don't know the answer. Mass participation. The new dimension is introduced in mass communication in the last perhaps 20-22 years. Actually after CNN and others start their game, which will be after the Kuwait war. This is the mass participation has reached the largest ever networking in the world. Nowhere in the world has mass communication or the mass level communication reached such bizarre levels. Almost every man is accessible to some form of influence. Second characteristic is not only its gigantic size and breadth, it's a two-way communication that has started, especially in the early part of the 21st century. A two-way communication means that the leader or the drum beater or somebody or the radio doesn't speak to me. I can speak back through the Twitter, through the Facebook, through other methods, and I can get my voice back and I can put my own opinion back. This one is another second development. Both the size which has exploded beyond control, I'm using the word beyond control because I do look after a machinery that has to look after mass communication. It's really beyond control. And it's a two-way communication. Students of mass communication need to remember that mass communication has turned from one-way communication to two-way, and this two-way is going to cause a lot of problems and a lot of advantages. We have a system of message and feedback. You will notice that even token two-way communication is resorted to by TV channels when they put, this is what XYZ said in Twitter. Earlier we had a non-live form when on Vivid Bharati you would hear that Ram Prasad from Jhumri Talaiya wants this. But it comes in as a non-live communication. Here it is on a live basis. I'm just describing the social media, all other forms. The world's connectivity has reached, as I said, bizarre proportions. Where does it lead us to the next part of the topic? Transformative government. The power of the mass media to transform the world was a very dramatic knock on the wall, which comes up practically in the last 5 to 7 years. Before that, the power of mass communicating with the masses and garnering their support or their anger was used to full measure either in war or in elections, to drum up patriotic fervor in every country, to drum up a lot of emotions, or during elections. But as I said, it was a one-way communication. Transformative governance, which means that one speaks to another and one gets together in some sort of a cooperative movement, starts with the practically, if you ask me to put the date in international affairs, I'll put it as Tunisia 2010. When Ben Affleck or somebody sets in terms of fire, and we didn't know what had happened. So the power of igniting emotions catches on, and what is known as Arab Spring. We had before us, our generation, I see quite a lot of us, we had the Prague Spring of 1968, when Dubček challenged the might of the Soviet army, Red Army. But then it was an affirmative action, which did not have a two-way communication built in. The implied relationship is that mass communication in whatever palpable form, that government can be transformed through mass communication. This is the sum and substance of the implied topic. Well, the best example I can give is our Prime Minister, Mr. Modi. He garnered the power of mass communication as nobody else before him had done. And he is here where we are. The question is, how much of social media actually counted for the vote, or is it a matter of speculation and hype? This has to be gone into. And there have been books coming out, Rajdeep starts the first trend, and we start speculating, because such a wave that actually cascaded out all walls of caste and other denominators in elections had never happened before. People were still calculating their Kurbis and Koiris would do this, and finally the wave just got through. But the question is, can we establish a relationship between his mastery over mass communication and the transformative government he brought? Hold it, let's see. And the other that comes to my mind is Anna Hazare. In fact, Subhashji was referring to Anna Hazare's speeches, and I, after quite a few days of secretary, the government of India, where I'm extremely loyal, I'm supposed to be. I used to watch the television, and I found it just too exciting to miss. So let's see what it's all about. I mean, why do you have to see it on TV? Why do you have to see it second hand? What's so great? I mean, like, it's not insurrection if you take part. Of course, if caught at that time, then we held. The other is AAP. The AAP party itself arises out of a mass movement. Now, I would again draw a little parallel. So do we mean to say that before this TV, television and others came in, there is no mass movement? There is no transformative government? What about Dandi? What about other movement? What about Quit India movement? They were also forms of mass communication. So how are we distinguishing? What's so great about the 21st century? What's great about it? Let's try exploring the relation. Mass media played a bigger role abroad. This is what I was mentioning, and I'll just refresh your memory with a few examples. Tahrir Square, where it reached the crescendo of social media. At the World Media Congress, Global Media Forum last year, I had the good fortune of coming across the Tahrir Square players and talking from the first hand. I met the doctor who started it all. He was actually a dentist who got bored with the Egyptian regime and started spoofing it, lampooning it on the internet. From the internet picks up, and then it picks up into a movement. So Tahrir Square is one, but I have purposely given you another example, Taksim Square. That's in Turkey, in Istanbul. This is in Istanbul. So there it didn't succeed. The fact that mass communication or mass movement mobilization can wreak havoc or can cause dislocation and can do a lot of, let us say, angst build up, does not necessarily mean that it will succeed all the time. I was in Hong Kong and I was unable to go because these fellows had taken over the entire area, and one had to found the best way of bags onto the public transport and go, because that's the only transport that moved. But Hong Kong, after 3 months or 4 months of protracted battle, they didn't win. Tiananmen Square, they didn't win. Here again, I'm mentioning Tiananmen Square. So let us disabuse our minds of this thought that mass communication or the power to mobilize masses is A, something that has been born in the 21st century. My answer is no. B, it has been brought to its full play in the 21st century. There is no doubt about it. The size of rallies gets maddening. It gets maddening because you have screens and you have sound boxes that can reverberate, that can cascade, that can multiply over a lot of area where the person standing is unable to see for himself the leader or the speaker. To that extent, the extension, the advantage of extension is there, so the rally sizes are bigger. Public transport, transport is available. Serving political crisis. Again, I am giving another failed attempt. This gripped the whole world. Nothing could be done. So there is a question of, I have given the successful examples, I have given the ones that excited, and I am giving the failures as well. It's not necessarily that every attempt at galvanizing the masses would lead to a positive change. Now, we made some impact studies. What is mass and what is communication? Coming back to the question, what would you identify as mass? How are the forms of media impacting on them? Because our communication was focusing itself on the mediums of communication, which in proper English is known as media. Newspaper readership. Readership over here, but anyway, readership in India has reached around 25 crores. What is our population? 127 crores. Assuming that all of them are reading the political news, they are also reading it in about 100,000 papers, 1 lakh papers. Assuming that 1 lakh papers are screened out and you have a choice of some 20,000, the fragmentation of readership has to be understood. So there is no herding of viewpoints. You cannot herd it in one side and say this is the official viewpoint, this is the consensus viewpoint. So here we have a population of close to 130 crores. I don't know why we are sticking to 125 as if baby production has stopped. It's 130 crores and more. We have 1 lakh newspapers, assuming that even 10,000 of them make some amount of impact. The fragmentation is clear. 25 crore readers, the reach is about 20%, 19.2%. This is one of the most powerful methods of mass communication. But I would submit, I don't worry, I'll leave this paper behind and it will be put on the web if you want. Except maybe one sentence which I'll censor later. So is it really mass communication? Impact study 2. Indian TV viewers. Everybody's glued to TV. Everybody's glued to TV, and TV is a tremendously powerful medium, and therefore we can galvanize them to think in some terms of transforming government. Good. We have 17 crore TV households, and the estimated viewer is 75 crores. That is a large component of 125 crores. And here, excepting Kapilaji was here, excepting people like Kapilaji, everybody else watches TV. And I'll give you a secret, I don't. 7.5% view news. It doesn't matter with the 75 crore viewers, only 7.5% watch news. So that is something you need to factor in. Because our emotional outreach is through news. And there's anyone who knows what the nation wants. One good news I can give you. Doordarshan's problem is, I don't want to go in for self-advertisement or self-seek. It's not all the time worth advertising. But we changed the English news last year, and I had a bit of, year before last, and a bit of a problem with the then minister. We brought in an English news at 9 o'clock. I was saying people are getting tired of my good friend and So we should bring it in English news, and there was opposition, kya aap Hindi news ko hata rahe ha, main hata nahi raha hu, 8 baje mere news hai, 10 baje ke baad bhi you can have Hindi news, beech mein 9 baje let's have an English news. So we got in this fancy looking girls and boys, one of them is here. So we got them on at interesting negotiated rates, and the babus in my ministry saw white murder. Until I explained that the cumulative salary that we have packaged, we are paying them, is more or less equal to that of someone between a deputy secretary and joint secretary. So the joint secretary said, they are not crossing our rank in terms of emolument, I said, no. Relax. So I'll never be able to understand many people, and they are one of them. So we got good smart readers from this thing. Actually, I poached one from Arnab also. So, but then, the next point is very interesting. English news is only 0.1%. So ladies and gentlemen, keep this news embedded in your mind every time you want to appear in NDTV or somewhere or somewhere. Kul milake it is 0.1%. Which I'm never tired of telling Suhail, Sait and others. There's 0.1%. Yeah, no. I said, okay, that's a smart 0.1%. I said, I have to ask the Hindi readers whether they're unsmart. You can start with Subhati, you can kill him. So, a point is 0.1% is the impact of English news. Bar, bar, I can say, English news is 0.1%. You can pretend to be a lot, you can have fancy looking person, you can be tucking in fancy looking pens. Fact is, you don't matter, excepting amongst yourself as a tribal group, saying the reassuring each other in something that is known as PLUs, people like us. We like to feel fancy about it, that's all. But here, the interesting part of my story with Arnab, which I never tire of telling him, he said, Dada, next week, is that 1 hour of English news, which is called News Night at 9 o'clock, we beat him twice to thrice over. And every time he shouts, I get more viewers.
It's a very wide coverage, apart from everything else.
So, we have a large coverage, we don't pick out a particular topic with a pen and be the judge and the jury. They're a nice guy otherwise, he was a nice chap when he was in NDTV. Now, TV reach, television reach, I'm coming to the other part of television reach, 130 crore population and 3.5% watch Hindi news. Do you think the 3.5% is changing the world? 0.1 to they can't. And the assumption is they can't. The accent can be very good, everything can be very good, but you are not changing the world, buddy. So, 3.5% is Hindi news, 2.8% is regional news. So you are taking 14 major languages there. You can count how much percentage it comes to. And 51% is general entertainment, the popcorn eating, a chip eating lady. 51%. So let's get our figures clear. I have to work a little hard for this. I'll leave it behind with Prism and others. You can circulate it. 51% is the general entertainment content watches, channel watches. 51%. So at any point of time, the Hindi news readers who are fighting and screaming at each other, or the Bangla or the Odia Hindi news persons, they might have for 2.8%. Rajni Bahuti is much, much more than that. Bahubi Saas Banegi will be more than this. So, there you have 1.7% watch sports, which is more than any regional language. But 16.4% watch Hindi movies. So, if you want to give your message, I think smuggle it in Hindi movies. I just saw one where I had the gentleman of my era, Manoj Kumar, and today another patriotic thing. So, this is the reach of television. Now coming to the third part, is it really mass communication? This is an interesting statistic I managed to find out. We have 73 crore active mobile users today. We have around 95 crore, 92 to 93 crore registered mobile users. And 75 crores, but today's figure is 73 crores. I have given you the letter one. Last month it was around 80 crores. Okay, out of 125 crores, so somebody, everybody is using the mobile, excepting the very young and the very old. So that's a summation. There's nothing to sort of gloat about, because in Malaysia, the ratio is about 1.7. We are 0.8 and they are 1.7 to 8 and they are 1.7. So even other countries of the world have it. Other countries, our mobile growth has been aided, if I may put the word term, by the complete ineffectiveness of state telephones. So that had come into the rescue, and had it not been for mobiles, we would have been an incommunicado nation. 30 crore internet users in India. I am using the figure, but I have a little doubt about it, as what do you constitute as internet speed? We are using 256 a speed, now we have gone up. 250 is a lot of speed. But tell, at it, when somebody you are able to connect to the internet. And let's find out who follows, people who follow social media, who follow social media. 70% said, well, sometimes. 5.5% say not at all. I'm sure there are some persons in the room who don't go to the internet at all, social media at all. 25% are saying regularly. If 25% of India is using social media regularly, its percentage equals that, crosses that of the press, which was 19.2, if you remember, print media. All the newspapers and all the barons and all the printing houses put together and accounting for 19.2%. And social media, with just a few catalytic companies and groups, I'm not using the term internet, internet is much more. Social media in the form of approved social media and OTT, that over-the-top mechanisms like WhatsApp and Instagram and others, that's 25%. So we come back after a lot of pessimism to say that yes, 25% does matter a lot, and it does make sense. But 130 crore population, 103 crore netizens, that is a lot. Even if they're occasionally, accessing the internet, 100 crores. So that is a lot. But 20% social media reach. 20% social media reach is, as I said, equal to that of the print media, more than that of the print media. So this is the sector which is going to go up. If you ask me today, what do you see of the future of television? I would say that we started television from an age, we started computers from an age when things were much more antiquated. As I'm fond of saying, I saw the first computer in India in Jadavpur University. A computer consisted of about 40 or 50 steel almirahs occupying this whole room. Its power was less than that. Its power was less than that of a mobile capacity. And from there we have traveled a long way. The big computer became multi-user and then became personal computers. If you are ever wondering why we called the desktop as PC, it has nothing to do with Mr. Chidambaram. Mm. It is, he just lowered taxes. It means your personal computer. You don't have to go to office and queue up. You don't have to go to a common user facility. This comes in, and it comes in India in the 80s and becomes the most fashionable furniture in every bureaucrat's room. We used to go, we were introduced to it. I had one in my room which had this burqa on it. And nobody even opened it. We tried opening it, and I have seen the transformation in the age. We used to put floppies, and floppies really flopped. Like jalebis, kache jalebi. We used to put it in, and you could finish the whole day's newspaper. It would make all sorts of sounds and lights like ET, chincha, chincha. It would go on finishing the newspaper. By that time, DOS data operating system has come up. And that is, I'm talking 1990. By 2000, the world had changed. Every kid wanted it. And by 2005, it was all on handheld mobiles. Today, when I'm talking to you, the number of handheld devices, which is called smartphone or tablet, has reached 150 million. As against 75 crore households, 17.5 crore TV households, we have 15 crore smartphones and tablets. It's just a question of reaching it. There are various options, and one of them, as you know, is 4G, which provides the internet highway. There are these OTTs like Netflix and others that keep offering TV and mobile programs. And good old Doordarshan is also trying its digital towers. In a couple of years, the whole situation is going to change from the static big room computers and TV, you are coming down to smaller ones. Now, desktop as a fancy instrument where you don't have to strain your neck and eyes, and TV on a regular screen will be seen only on Sundays. The rest of it is this. If my generation was portrayed like this, the present generation was portrayed like this. So it's going to come up, and we can't stop it. So this is where the penetration of net and internet matters the most. And next part. Does it lead to transformation, would lead to an understanding of the processes? Here I would give the greatest contribution to RTI, right to information. When it was introduced, I was in the state government. There were huddled meetings as to how to tackle this new beast. How dare they ask for us for sacred notings on file? Our notings on file are our property. How we decide on the state of the union is none of your business. You do not understand the process. In any case, you can take my notes, you will not understand because we write whereas and undersigned and therefore and in exercise path. It's not English. And then we went through all sorts of methods and I watched with amusement what was going on. And finally, the walls started cracking. And then you had sharpshooters like this gentleman who has nothing better to do, while RTI are this and that and this and that. And finally, you have a situation where the walls have cracked and people have got it. Various attempts are made at various points of time by people, mainly of my tribe, to go back to good old days. Remember, the word secretary comes from the keeper of secrets. So if there are no secrets, what do we name him? To think of a new term. There are no secrets. So RTI is proving to be a fascinating instrument where you can open the processes. It gets to be a bit of a nuisance. Where every time I go to go out, they say, what was my car number? Where did I go out with? Did I have a companion? What nonsense? Anyway, so the next is the question of kingmaker. Social media's kingmaker. Here I can give you one example, one study which is rather relevant. Did it really matter where, let us say, Mr. Modi's election came? Well, to quantify it is a bit difficult, but it was said that there were 160 seats where the SM factor mattered. Even if you assume that even 3% swing happened, 3% is a lot of number. I had unfortunately been election commission of a very difficult state called West Bengal. And we have Mrs. Mamata Banerjee on one side and somebody on the other, you don't know what it is. So, very interesting period. Now, 3% swing is a lot. Even if you account for a 2%, 3% swing out of the 20% in any way, you hit the jackpot. We aren't empirically substantiating, we're not able to empirically substantiate, but empiricism in social sciences is, as Manjuka knows, it's all there. You have to take a call on it. So, kingmaker, yes, the connectivity in the world. The entire world's connectivity reaches bizarre proportions. We really don't know what is going to come up next. Correspondence in India comes out in the United States in great detail. Somebody says, somebody paid somebody some incentive and something happens in a beach state, okay, you don't know who's impacting whom. I mean, tomorrow morning I might get something saying one ambassador said I said something unprintable. So you then you don't know what's happening. So it starts with this Assange, WikiLeaks, goes on to Snowden, and you don't know where it's going to snowball next. Now NSA was caught, NASA was caught, NSA was also caught spying on their neighbors. So this sort of transparency is what is the important factor that we need to watch about. It is not the mass mobilization, it is the fact of knowing what's going on, knowledge being power. And how does this knowledge operate? This is the clue that I would like to contribute or give. It's digital openness. The fact of heads must roll. Just have a look at it. If you go back to the history of India and the relationship with the mass media or the common media, you would find that this is not the first time the press has scored a point. They scored a point in T.T. Krishnamachari, Sahu Jain case. It has scored points elsewhere. Nowhere could the press demand from the government that you make him resign. Ms. Pandit Nehru made his finance minister resign because a son-in-law, I mean, they always have this son-in-law, this Feroz Gandhi I'm referring to. Feroz Gandhi made this revelation and he made him resign in the 50s, 60s. But that was not a mass transformation. And it was more of a voluntary as a gentleman that he can resign the role. But here was, I was a witness to the developments between September 2010 and January 2011. I'm perhaps only member of that Commonwealth Games Committee who's not been indicted, I should say so. No, because I had nothing major to do except to put that gas balloon up, that closing and opening ceremony, which I thought was pretty neat. In fact, most people say it was better than the games. So, at the aerostat, we don't know what to do with it. Now, at the culture with, I'm not taking part in sports. So, from September till 2010, when the floods took over the stadium, took over the Asian village, the Commonwealth village, we've been watching. And I found that excepting those 16 days of the games, they went back to him. And they went and went and went until he resigned. First they took that little plumpish sort of a man who was his right hand. And then they took a very thin man who was his left hand. And it went on. But basically I could see the target was him. Heads must roll. After that, you had heads must roll every month. And then, Swaji, every week. Every week we want bada bhook lag rahi hai. So this started. Then comes bring Lokpal. Then comes the Nirbhaya outbreak. I'm just graphically telling you what it happened. Till September 2010, you were allowing Telgi and that Khan fellow and that Pune cash converter of RSA government to get away with it. You were summoning a lieutenant governor from some state and letting at government getting away with it, hoping people forget. But the press, mass media forcing through a unison that this is the system. Somebody has to pay the cost for Commonwealth Games and going. And then Lokpal and then Nirbhaya outrage. Nirbhaya outrage was, in my humble opinion, the first time when social media in India beat the system. I was asked by commentators because I had already crossed over to the press side. I was just a few feet away at Parliament Street from this Isla Hill outrage. And the older generation was taken aback because during the freedom movement you never occupied riders on Isla Hill. So who are this bunch of kids to come and occupy? And putting at the, you know, pushing at the barricades. Climbing the pillars. So this was taken aback and my fellows looked nonplussed and said, do we cover it? I said, of course we cover it. Are you sure, sir, we cover it? Chandraji, up to predecessors. I said, of course you cover it. It's a news. For God's sake, it's news. Cover it. But don't you think it's disruptionist news? I said, I don't think. Just send it. Send people and cover it. I don't relish it, but you cover it because everybody else is covering it. So I sent this monkey girl who just rolled her sleeves and went there with the camera and started asking. Then I had to tap her and say, hey, you're not on their side. You're supposed to be neutral. This is this time. But how did they get together? That itself is a story that people like Rajdeep must bring up. SMS, tweets, social media messaging. There can be no watch on that. You can't tap that. So they just got together and took the nation by surprise. Activism. Raising awareness. It can be both. I've given the anti-government side and I've given the and now bringing out the social side. Amir Khan. We shared him. They shared his feed and of course extended it to a lot of people because we found him rather expensive. I counted to see how many every time he cried, somebody had to pay a crore. Harnessing support, and this one was a dead case of Rasika Lal, was revived in 2006. Dead case. And then you have what I call camera worthy items, like a DIG or IG grinning like a dash dash dash. Why do you have to grin? I mean, like, if you have not molested the girl, then just keep a straight face. He was grinning as if no law on earth can catch me. And this is something that triggers emotions within people, even normal people. This is the power of sight, light, and vision. As I said, kingmaker, government transformation achieved, making a difference. I've come to this in the past. I have said 160 seats is what is said to have tilted. And then comes the reverse swing, the pendulum swing. Complete from this end to that end. So you better stay out of the pendulum side because you don't know who's going to bonk next. But then, it's a key enabler. This was the last issue of the Economist before elections. And the next issue I was looking for the cover, Hail the Great Man. I mean, this is the fickleness of the press. It's public appeal, relevant, it's easy to consume, easy to share, coherence, real world connection and consistent communication. You see, some of the advantages of social media are great. Whatever you say, you have to say it within 140 characters. And all that was one is watching is within 140 characters. Leadership, personalities, shaping opinion, these are the key enablers that you have leaders, but they can sort of extend their persona onto this domain and give the impression that, we are on consultative board. The critical issues. This is where I start concluding. You see, when you talk of governance, I'm now making a difference between government and governance. Government is what changes, what comes up, the political end, the executive ones. They keep saying that this is a bad transfer, this is a good transfer, why do you do this, why do you do that? After 40 years in civil service, I've been on the receiving end, I've been on the tata goodbye ends. But I would submit that if you have come through with a political mandate, you are like a musician who has the right to bring his own tabalchi. So to that extent, let us forgive the political system because they need people of their side. I mean, I don't mean that they should always cross the red line or something. In fact, they should not go near the red line also. But government is one thing, the governance is completely different. Has the inspector of whatever stopped asking for hafta? Has police brutality stopped? Has this handshake stopped? That is governance. This is the worrisome part. Government per se can be changed and toppled. And what frustrates me is that one change does not mean the other changes. So governance will take much more than just the social media. We reach the stage of maturity. Transformative government governance is a reality check. This is the picture. This is there before the gentleman from the party came. This will be there after it. Because this is rather difficult to tackle. This calls for systems. But what is the hope? Let's end with the hope. We have all migrated our correspondence, excepting those who write by longhand. I don't know how many people do, excepting answer scripts. Everybody else is talking on the type mode or digital mode. The moment you come into the digital sphere, you are actually reducing all your efforts to binaries, to digits. The moment you get into a digit as your form of expression in whatever, you're open. There is nil security. Nil security. Whom I rang up between 6 and 7 while coming to IIC, you can just take it back after 5 years from the records. There's no security in voice, in call, in type, in anything. There's absolutely no security. You've reached the lowest denominator, I call it, the digital alphabet. All communication becomes open. WikiLeaks, Assange, Snowden. The question is, governments are now very cautious. When I mean governments, I mean even corporate bodies are very, very cautious. So after the conversation between a lady in Delhi and a corporate gentleman in Bombay came out, kuchikus and sweetie
nice,
pies,
nice dress
and all that, then nothing that's sort of, that can't come out. I don't know who's taping what. TV stinks hate corruption. That's a fact. But this cat and mouse game will go on. But remember, the hope lies for people like me in what I call the digital alphabet. The digital alphabet, once released, remains in the public sphere. You can always get it back. It has caused havoc. The fact that my conversation today can be cut into bits, I don't know what the gentleman will do, and they can pick up a sentence and then put it on the Twitter and put it up on links and all that, and tomorrow morning I will, whatever little job I have, and it's quite possible. I mean, one doesn't know where one stands. The digital alphabet is dangerous. The fact that all communication has to be digital ensures that it is open to scrutiny. Legally, illegally, semi-legally. Either today or tomorrow. So you're not safe. And citizens are watching. They're watching you. This is a guarantee for transformative governments tomorrow. Because governance means something different from government. So the two are assumed to be part of the same transaction. Sometimes they are, because there are people, there are governments where postings are charged for and paisa has to be vasooled after that. So there are these situations, but otherwise, I would still say digital alphabet is dangerous. All communication remains open, verbal, written, pictorial, audiovisual, everything is open. And this, in my humble opinion, is the first hope of transformation. Transformative government would come from this. Thank you.